Good afternoon. I am presenting today on behalf of my colleagues from Thailand, the PHPT research team. The original design, I don't know how this works. The original design of PHPT5 was to compare three PMTCT treatment regimen. The standard of care at the time in Thailand, where mothers would receive AZT for 3 months during pregnancy, then the child also would have 1 week of AZT, and the mother would receive single dose nevirapine during the time of labor, and the child also immediately after birth would receive single dose nevirapine. Then we wanted to avoid resistance mutations in the mother, so we compared that to an arm where the mother would receive the same treatment with AZT, but without intrapartum nevirapine, and then an arm where the mother was on heart, on lopinavir, ritonavir-based heart. The study was stopped early because of a change in the national guidelines, which recommended heart for all women, regardless of their CD4 count. The transmission rates across arm were similar, a little bit on the high side, and we saw that 80% of the transmission, which occurred in women who had received a short treatment duration during pregnancy. So we redesigned the study to look at postnatal treatment intensification in children to see if we could at least prevent intrapartum transmission related to this short treatment duration of treatment in women. The question was, how do you design a study like that? Obviously, ethically, we did not want to choose a placebo-controlled study in high-risk infants. Moreover, we in Thailand at the time, the mother-to-child transmission rates were already very low, and the prevalence of HIV in pregnant women was also very, very low. But we had a very solid prior knowledge of the efficacy of such an intervention. Single-dose nevirapine is a postnatal intensification in a way. And we had quality historical data that we could use to establish this clinical trial. So we opted for a multi-center phase three adaptative single-arm clinical trial with three interim analyses, which would allow early stopping of the study in case of futility or in case of proven efficacy. So this is the design. The normal treatment for women was to start with heart, and then the child would receive AZT for 4 weeks. But if the mother had a short treatment duration, and this you can know at the time of delivery, then intensification would be given to the mother, single dose nevirapine in the mother during labor, and a 1 month continuation of the heart treatment for the mother, and 2 weeks of AZT, CTC, nevirapine for the child, followed by 2 weeks of AZT, CTC, here again, to avoid the selection of resistance mutations. Now, we used a Bayesian approach to do the study. So, contrary to classic statistical approach, in Bayesian spirit, we do not consider that we know nothing before we do the experiment. We actually, we know a lot, and we had a lot of prior information about the characteristics of the women, the virus load decline, and the different types of treatment, the transmission rates, and the different conditions. And so we had this knowledge. We could then create scenarios where in the intervention arm, the new data to be collected, we looked at different sample size, different transmission rates, and then we could simulate posterior distribution. You see in this graphic that in this case we would have started with one prior probability and end up with a totally modified probability after the experiment. So we did a meta-analysis of all the previous data we had. We modeled the virus load decline and the therapy. We modeled intrapartum transmission. We predicted the intrapartum transmission with or without intensification. And then we simulated the posterior distributions. And the result was this table where you can see that if you look at the first sample size, 58 women being enrolled, if you have no transmission, you go down and you see that you have you continue the study. But then if after 118 women being enrolled in the study, you still have no transmission, then you can stop because you have proven beyond doubt that the intervention is working. Conversely, if after 58 women and children being enrolled, you've seen two transmission, then you can stop the study because clearly the intervention is not working. At the first interim analysis, we had passed the 58 sample. We had no transmission. The DSMB told us to continue the study, but we noticed that the enrollment was low, much lower than actually what we had feared. In the second interim analysis, we had not yet reached 118 patients, and the DSMB told us stop enrollment and report the results. So you see here the inclusion criteria. Exclusion criteria, we screened more than 1,000 women. 377 were enrolled and 88 were in the intervention group, had a short treatment, so their children received intensification, and 248 were in the observational group where there was no intervention. And I forgot to say that by intrapartum transmission, we define intrapartum transmission by the fact that the child was negative at birth and positive after 1 month of life. So you see here the characteristics of the women. Obviously, the women in the intervention group started therapy much later than the ones in the control group. Here is the duration of heart, 4 weeks in the intervention group, 19 weeks in the control group, receiving the same treatment during pregnancy. And the intensification, as you can see, was done very fast. The majority of the women or the children received intensification within less than 1 hour of birth. Then what we did after finishing enrollment was to rerun the analysis that we had done to establish the study. We updated the meta-analysis of the mother-child transmission. We remodeled or we updated the modeling of the decline of virus load and the therapy because we had much more data on heart. We recalibrated the model, predicted in prior intrapartum transmission probabilities, and updated the posterior distributions. So these are the prior probabilities. You see in the green on the left and the green curve, the probability of transmission without intervention, and in blue, the probability with the intervention, but that's the prior probability. And then if you take into account the 88 women that were enrolled and did not have any transmission, you see that the posterior probability in green is not changed. There is no reason for it to change, but the posterior probability of the intervention is much sharper and lower, and the probability of superiority of intensification over standard of care was 94% here, and the probability of at least a twofold reduction of the risk was 82.9%. There was no safety concern with the postnatal intensification, and so we could conclude that this intensification was effective and safe in preventing intrapartum transmission among these women and children with short course therapy during pregnancy. I would like to acknowledge the women and children in the study, all the co-investigators, there may be almost more co-investigators than people in the intervention group, and then the DSMB for their very good support. Thank you very much.